storage space forever. And, you know, this is like Deadhead Valhalla. That it would all be there. I mean, I don't know how many versions of Cassidy you were supposed to have got.
I think you could play Dark Star for 24 hours.
Yeah. Truly. And well, a lot of people do that, you know, just with the same one. But that's their point. He said, I feel like I need to talk to somebody. I mean, somebody in the band or somebody, I'm sort of nominally in the band. Somebody really in the band, somebody who gets up there and has to sweat bullets and possible, assassination and whatnot. So, tonight, maybe I should ask the lawyers. Oh, don't ask the lawyers. Don't ask anybody. Well, how about I sign? No, no. Don't ask them. I mean, because, as Garcia once said, the Grateful Dead is the storehouse of a broken dream. Because everybody that had a great idea at some point would have it shot down before they really got anything, except for the trip to Egypt, which was kind of a fluke. But I said, if they know about it, they're going to go into a ring of argument, and it won't get anywhere. And in the meantime, they'll force you to take all that stuff off. And I said, let's just leave it be until a huge amount has been uploaded. And the Deadheads have kind of started using it as a resource and are attached to it. And we'll just go ballistic when somebody tries to take it down. And besides, I've always felt that it's better to apologize and ask permission. So that was what we did, and it was, as I predicted, about a year and a half to 2 years before anybody from the band noticed. And then, then there were some of them that freaked out. No question about it, including my official best friend, who I was hoping to be here tonight. He's almost always got some road manager telling him what day of the week it is. And he found himself, as he put it, in another part of the space-time continuum, which is Stinson Beach. Right? Which is true, actually. Didn't make it in, and I'm sorry for that, because he still disagrees with what became our policy with regard to the internet right now. And that is that Phil, Bob Hunter, and I felt very strongly that this was a perfect continuity between the policy that we'd set forth first in a de facto way, and then it actually set out quite seriously a few years later, which was that if anybody was making non-commercial use of that material, then it was okay to share.
Yay!
Share. This is a long time before the conference. I think I was present for the founding discussions of Creative Commons, and the Dead example had a lot to do with it. The idea of non-commercial sharing and the success of non-commercial sharing. I mean, I firmly believe, I think that even my old pal Weir would admit that had it not been for all those tapes, and the spreading by not just word of mouth, but here, we would have gone the way of Quicksilver Messenger Service. There were a lot of good bands in the 60s that didn't make it because they didn't create this absolutely rabid and deep religious fan base. And that was based on those tapes. And, you know, and then, you know, they started to get kind of a baseball statistician's obsession. I don't get it, but obsession with the song order. Well, actually, I do get it. I mean, it's, we didn't have set lists, so, you know, to a very large extent, the deadheads out in the audience would determine the next song. And they knew that. So this was like this was the only thing that they could, you know, point to as a religious or religious-like connection with their holy phenomenon. And so then you had Stu Nixon, who was here tonight. I'll talk more about what is going to happen here. But Stu and his two buddies started up something called Dead Base, which was an aid to these people, where they were writing down, I think at this point, with quill pen, they were writing down every single song that was played at every single concert, and getting records, you know, getting just the metadata, so to speak, on all of the Grateful Dead music, and creating something called Dead Base, which now weighs, what is it, Stu, 33 pounds? Something like that. What's that?
7 pounds.
Oh, well, geez. I guess. I had a crippling event take place in April, and I'm, you know, 7, 33, they're both heavy as far as I'm concerned. That's so. But in any case, the real deal was what was set with the Deadheads and the Archive. What was set with the Deadheads to begin with, which is having a community bond together and do something that could not possibly have been accomplished by a single person, or even a group of people, or even any organized set of endeavors, doing this as a community. And, you know, it pointed the way in my mind, and Brewster's, I think, about how it was going to be possible to realize that dream that they gave us on the Flying Saucer. You know?
So I'd like to wrap up.
Oh, sorry. I beg your pardon. Let me quickly cut to the final end of the chase, which is that one loses track of time. I thought there was going to be a clock out here. Just a 0000. The thing is that we now, as Brewster said, have 6,000 bands that have found that it is in their best economic interest, as it was in ours, and certainly in the interest of posterity, to put their 120,000 concerts online, that we have a community of people, large community of people, that is dedicated not just with our music, but with a lot of people's music. And, you know, this endeavor is going to require the participation of just about everybody in the human race, and fortunately, that's what it's got coming to it. Thank you.
The night's not over.